golden fish fingers.
Golden fish fingers.
For your tea. Oven baking breadcrumbs for your Amiga 3. Catch them in that ocean blue. They've a lovely speckled hue. From the chilly North Pacific, golden fish fingers for you.
Hello, everybody. Hello, children. Welcome to today's online field trip. I'm Sam, and this is David, one of our experts for today's lesson. Hello, David.
Hello, Sam. Hello, children.
I say that David's one of our experts because we actually have three experts today. We also have James, who'll be cooking some tasty homemade fish finger sandwiches, and also another David, who'll be showing us around the fantastic trawler you can see behind us. Hello, both. We'll be checking in with both James and David throughout the course of today's lesson. I think first of all, though, we should find out who we have taking part. So let's meet our schools. Let's go to Forward Primary School now in Essex, where Miss Bird's class is taking part. Hello, children.
Hey, guys.
Fantastic stuff. Let's go over to Greenway Primary School now in Cardiff, where we have Mrs. Donnelly's class taking part. Hello, children.
Hi.
Let's go to Woodlands Academy now, where Mr. Handley's class is taking part. Hello, everybody.
Hey, guys.
Nice and loud there. And finally, let's go to Front Street Primary School, where Mr. Hollingworth's class is taking part in Newcastle. Hello, everybody.
Hi.
Fabulous stuff. We've got a lively bunch with us today,
Dave.
We really have. Now, as I said, we're in Grimsby, which is in Lincolnshire, which is in the east of England. We are surrounded by water at the moment, and as you may have noticed, we have a great big trawler behind us. So, David, whereabouts are we?
Well, today, Sam, we're at the Grimsby Fishing Heritage Centre. As you can see, we've got this lovely trawler behind us, and Grimsby actually used to be the biggest fishing port in the whole world, which is amazing. We're standing on the docks right now, and the docks are the place where the fishing boat ties up after its fishing trip, and it's where it brings its fish to shore, which is what we call landing the fish. So the fish here will go into the factories where we make the fish fingers that we'll be learning about today.
Great stuff. And you are a marine biologist, which sounds very fancy. So what do you do? What does that involve?
I'm a marine biologist, yes, Sam. So it's my job to know all about the things that live in the sea, so the fish, the dolphins, the octopus, all the things that are under the sea. So I have to learn all about those and how they live underwater and their lifestyles and the environment they live in, and make sure that we don't take too many of them, so we've got a sustainable resource for us all to keep eating fish fingers.
Great stuff. Very, very important job indeed.
Absolutely.
And so what are we going to learn while we're here, David?
Well, today, guys, we're going to learn about fish. So you can see we've got fish here. We've got a nice big hake. I don't know if you can see his teeth here. It's quite a scary looking fish, the old hake. We have a cod. You might be able to see this cod by here. You can see this little barbel on his chin, and that's like a little beard, but that's actually how he tickles along the seabed, and that's how he finds his dinner, that's how he finds his food.
Great.
Here we have a haddock. He's stuck into this little fish here. You might be able to just see here, he's got like a thumbprint on his side, and that's how you tell the haddock, because he's got this black thumbprint and a black line along the back, and he's got a kind of cool like quiff-like fin here. These are all nice white fish. Just going to show you some flat fish, which is a different type of fish. So you can see here he's quite flat. You can see these bright orange spots on a plaice, and that's how you know he's a plaice. And then here we've got a lemon sole, which is also a flat fish, but he's got a little bit of a smaller mouth because he eats little worms and smaller things. And you can see he's got a lemony type shape to him.
Fantastic. So you can make fish fingers with all of these?
Absolutely. So these are all what we call white fish. So they'll all make nice fish fingers. And then here's a block of fish here. So this is a block of fillet. So on board, the fishermen have filleted the fish when they've come aboard. And we chop these fish blocks up, which you'll learn about in the video later, into these little fish sticks here that are then turned into fish fingers using this flour here and using these breadcrumbs here. But we'll learn about that in a video very soon.
Great stuff. And we are going to be concentrating on Omega 3 fish fingers, aren't we, David? Because that's the type of fish fingers that are made in Grimsby, but they're not all made the same way, are they?
No, fish fingers can be made using many different types of fish, as we've seen here. And they can be made using batter, using breadcrumbs, making all sorts of different things. But the ones we're looking at are using a fish called Alaska pollock.
Fabulous stuff. Thank you, David. I think it's time we found out how James is getting on, because of course he is making us some lovely homemade fish fingers. So how are you getting on, James?
Okay, well, I'm making some, getting everything ready to cook our fish fingers for later, but I'm also going to be showing you later about tartar sauce and putting it all together and making a lovely fish finger sandwich.
Thank you so much, James. Can't wait to try those, David. That's probably the best bit, I think. Really nice. But back to these fish fingers that we have here, because you did say earlier on, David, that they're made by Alaska pollock. So I thought the fish fingers are made from cod.
Well, a lot of fish used to be made from cod, Sam, but it's important to try lots of different fish species, so we're not putting too much pressure on one individual fish stock, because if we eat too many of one fish, we might run out. And Alaska fish, Alaska pollock even, is a fish from the Bering Sea, west side of America, and we use this fish because it's very sustainable.
Okay, so they do taste very similar, and that's probably why I've never noticed that I'm not eating cod anymore.
Absolutely, they're all the same family, so these fish and Alaska pollock will be cousins, and it's the same sort of white fish, so you probably won't even notice the difference, to be honest, Sam.
Oh, great stuff. Well, I know that a lot of our children have been learning about golden fish fingers already, because as usual, we've had loads of resources and information online ready for you to learn before today's lesson. So I think we should go over to Fulwood Primary School now and find out what Miss Bird's class already knows about fish fingers before today's lesson. Who do we have there, Miss Bird? Yeah. What fact have you learned?
Up to 17 years.
That's great. So Sammy has just told us that Alaska pollock lived to up to about 17 years.
Yeah, sorry, that's a great fact, and that's absolutely true. 17 years is a really old age for quite a small fish, which is very interesting. I've got a good fact about fish age as well for you, Sammy. There's a fish called an orange roughy, which is a bit like a giant goldfish, and he lives very deep down in the sea. And those fish live up to 150 years old.
What? 150 years old. Great fact there, though, Sammy. Let's get another fact from Miss Bird's class.
As the Alaskan pollock gets older, they swim deeper towards the seabed.
Wow, that is a great fact. Let me just check this with David. So David, is it true that as Alaska pollock get older, they go deeper down towards the seabed?
Yes, Sam. Yeah, that's true. Another great fact. So when fish are born, they're born as tiny little eggs, very, very, very small. You're barely able to see them. And these eggs, they're very oily because they've got little bits of oil in for the baby fish to grow and live on before they hatch. And those float up to the surface, nearby the surface, and then the eggs will hatch into little tiny small fish. And then as these fish grow, they'll swim down to the seabed where their food lives and to stay away from predators like seabirds and seals and things like that. But great fact, yeah.
Very clever indeed. Right, let's get one more fact from Miss Bird's class.
Hello, I'm Aska, and fish need oxygen to survive just like humans.
That's a great fact, though. I think that was Aska. So fish need oxygen to survive, just like humans.
That's true, Aska. Good fact. So fish and all animals need oxygen to survive. So they can't breathe air because there's no air underwater. They have to get their oxygen from the water. So fish have these structures like gills. I might just quickly show you on this haddock. I'm not sure if you can see here these red-like structures here. And they're a kind of comb-like structure, and they use that to get oxygen out of the water so they can breathe. So we have lungs and the fish have gills. But great, great fact. Thanks for that one.
Great fact. Are you impressed with the learning that's gone on so far?
Very impressed, Sam. Very impressed.
Well done, children. Let's continue learning now. So, David, you said earlier on that Alaska pollock is a sustainable fish. What does that mean?
It is, yeah. We touched upon this word sustainable earlier, children. And basically, when fish is the last wild animal that we actually go out and catch. So if you think about your chicken and your pork and your beef, so your cows and your pigs, we all grow them on farms, so we grow them up and we breed them. Whereas with fish, they're wild in the sea, so we have to go out and catch them. And there's a finite number of those fish that replenish each year, but if we take too many, there's going to be no fish left for everyone else. So we have to be sure that there's enough fish, the fish stocks are big enough. We have to be sure that we're not taking too many, so we manage that properly and make sure that the fishermen take the right amount of fish every year. And we have to be sure that the fishing gear we use doesn't damage the seabed, because the seabed is important for the fish to grow. It's where a lot of fish live, it's their home. So we need to be sure that we look after all of that so we can all have fish into the future.
Fabulous. So your job is very, very important. It really is a scientific process, isn't it? Getting the fish for our fingers.
Absolutely, Sam. It's a very scientific process, and we spend a lot of time looking at this. And that's why companies that make fish fingers need to have marine biologists like myself.
Great stuff. It's time for a short video now, and this is all about Alaska pollock and how we catch them.
Fishing for Alaska pollock. Alaska pollock live in the Bering Sea, which is in the North Pacific Ocean, between the US state of Alaska and Russia. That's more than 4,000 miles away from us here in the United Kingdom. And it's these very fish that we use to make golden fish fingers. To catch the Alaska pollock, the fishermen use a large ship called a factory trawler. They are called factory trawlers because they are able to process the fish as soon as they are caught, like floating factories. These huge boats go to sea for 2 to 3 weeks at a time and have everything on board that the crew needs to live and work there, even a TV and the internet. Also on board is lots of high-tech equipment that the fishermen use to find the schools of Alaska pollock. When they find the fish they're looking for, the fishermen lower this cone-shaped net to a point in the water that is halfway between the boat and the ocean floor. This makes sure that they don't damage the ocean bed. The specially shaped net is designed to avoid catching other sea creatures, like whales or crabs, at the same time. Each net has a sensor that lets the captain know when the net is full of fish so that he can pull the net back up. Soon after being caught, the Alaska pollock are killed, cleaned, and filleted before being frozen into blocks like this. None of the catch is wasted, and the rest of the fish is turned into something called fish meal, which is used for animal food, or turned into bio-oil, which helps fuel the trawler. In order to protect the oceans, it's important that the fishermen are careful not to catch more fish than can be naturally replaced. Here in the Bering Sea, the fish stocks are carefully monitored to make sure that no more than 15 out of every 100 fish are caught. Once the trawler has caught as much pollock as it can carry, the frozen blocks of fish are sent across the seas to the port of Grimsby in Lincolnshire, where they will be turned into a tea time favourite, golden fish fingers.
Welcome back, children. We hope you enjoyed that. How exciting was that trawler? I don't think I'd fare too well on there. You'd need your strong sea legs to be on there. Now we are on the trawler and we've gained another expert. We've gained another David. Thanks for joining us, David. Now, David works here at the Grimsby Heritage Fishing Centre. So what is your role here?
Well, my job is the education officer at the museum. So it's my job really to help people to understand and learn as much as they can about the wonderful, rich heritage that we've got at Great Grimsby.
This is a very, very exciting trawler here. So can you tell us a little bit about this?
It is. We're standing on one of the most special things that we've got to help people understand about the past, that is the Ross Tiger. Really, I think we've got a film that can help us understand what people used to do on these ships. They would stand on this deck, which is the weather deck here on the fish deck, with six men along the rail having to haul in over 100 foot of trawl, with the water coming over the railings at the waist. They would have ice in their hair, they would have frostbite even in their fingers. That had to be so tough to work on a ship like this.
Wow, so lots and lots of hard work goes into
Definitely. The nets would have to then be lifted up using the big heavy winches to lift up to 2 tons of fish. They'd swing it onto the deck here, and all of this would be covered in the fish. And they would all then have to be gutted on the deck because that helps them to stay as fresh and in as good a condition as possible. And then they're washed before they go down to the fish room underneath us to be put into ice.
Fabulous stuff. Well, we have got some archive footage of that, and it does look such hard work, doesn't it, really? I mean, is it similar nowadays? Do people go out on a trawler like this, and is it just as hard work, or is this extra hard work we're seeing on the screen?
Well, the Ross Tiger's what we would call a vintage trawler, so she was designed and built in the 1950s. So thankfully today it is a lot safer, and the men don't have to work in such an exposed condition as they do on this ship. It's almost like a factory underneath where the fish is taken below, and it's much safer out of all the cold and wind and spray.
Great stuff. Well, we are going to take a look below deck in a second, as where the fish go when they go down the hatch. I think we should get some questions first, because I think the children are probably really excited to talk to you both. So let's go over to Fulworth Primary and see if Miss Kelly's class have any questions for you.
Hi, I'm Army. Why did you decide to be a marine biologist?
That's a really great question. So Army would like to know, why did you decide, David, to become a marine biologist?
Oh, an interesting question, Sam. And Army, I think I wanted to be a marine biologist when I was little and went down to the beach. You've all been down the beach on the holidays, I'm sure. And you see starfish and you look over under rocks and you find little crabs and seaweed and seagulls. And I always found that really interesting. And I've always liked to eat seafood and I've liked the sea and boats. So that kind of mystery and excitement has always got me keen. So I went and made a career out of it.
Good stuff. Really cool job, isn't it, children? Let's get another question. Let's go back over to Miss Kelly's class.
Hello, my name's Atavi. We know that marine biologists have to absorb things and record their findings, but how do they record information underwater?
That's a great question, Atavi. So Atavi would like to know how you record things underwater. Surely you don't take a pad and pen, David?
You don't know, Sam, and that's a great question. I wondered this myself when I started to study marine biology, because if you're out and about in the woods and you count trees, for example, you can write it down on your clipboard. But how do you do that underwater? Well, interestingly, there's special technology that helps us out and it helps me do this. So sometimes we have waterproof paper, so you can use a normal pencil, and underwater when you're counting your fish or you're watching your corals and things, you can write it down on that. When you've got your scuba gear on, sometimes they have these big helmets and you can actually talk through a radio, just like when you're talking on the phone to the guys up at the surface. And then another thing is, when it's really deep or the weather's really bad or you're looking at special things that might be dangerous to send a person down, we've got submarines we can send down, we've got big cameras on poles, and we can bring fish up in nets so we can look at it from the safety of a boat or even bring it back to shore to see. So that's how we get our data. Great question, thanks.
Really good question and a really good answer as well, David. Let's go over to Greenway Primary now to see if Mrs. Donnelly's class have any questions for our Davids.
My name is Lucius. And my question is, what is the most terrifying fish you have ever seen?
That's a really good question, Lucia. So Lucia would like to know, what's the most terrifying fish you've ever seen, David?
It is a good question. I've seen a lot of scary fish in my time. I think the most terrifying fish was a big shark, like you might have seen those sharks on Finding Nemo, so it was one that looked a bit like that. We pulled up a big trawl when I was working on board a fishing boat and we were expecting some nice cod and had it, like what we saw earlier for the fish fingers. And actually there was a big shark in the net, so we were all very scared and we had to be very, very careful to let it out of the net and put him back to sea safely so he didn't bite any of our toes.
Fabulous stuff. Let's get one last question now from Mrs. Donnelly's class.
My name is Dustin, and my question is, what is the most unusual fish you've ever seen?
Great question, Bethan. Bethan would like to know what's the most unusual fish you've ever seen, David.
Most unusual fish? That would have to be the sunfish, I think, Bethan. So I was actually down in Cornwall and Devon, where you guys might have been on holiday, maybe. And it's a big fish. It's about as tall as me and about this wide. And it's a big kind of oval shape. And then it's just got two big fins on the tail. And this fish was lying on its side on the sea surface. And I thought it was a bit poorly, a bit unwell. So I went to see. And actually, it turned out it was one of these sunfish. And they eat jellyfish, which you might see on beaches. And they don't look very tasty to me. But these sunfish seem to love them. But they have to go down very deep to get them. And the water gets down very cold when they're deep. So they have to lie on the surface and warm up their bodies in the sun like lizards might do to get enough warmth to keep going. So keep your eyes out on holiday if you're ever down in Devon and Cornwall for a sunfish.
Oh yeah, definitely great tip, and what a great story as well. Really good questions, children. Don't worry, Woodlands Academy and Front Street Primary, there'll be an opportunity to ask our David some questions later on in this online field trip. Time for something very exciting now, because I know David has told us the whole process about what happens to the fish when they're on deck. They go down this hatch, don't they, David? Under the deck.
They do, to the fish room underneath us.
And earlier on, we had a sneak peek, and this is what we found. So here we are below deck, right below the hatch that we saw when we were on the deck. This is where the fish get thrown down, isn't it, David? And then what happens when they get down here?
That's right. Well, they have to all be sorted out. So the ship's mate, that's the second in command on the ship, he has to sort all the fish into different types and then quite quickly get them into the ice. So what we're looking at there is a layer of wooden pound boards, all being iced, with the fish tightly packed together there with the noses to the fish's tails. You'd put ice on the top of them, and they needed a lot of ice on the ship to keep it fresh. That's 40 tons that the ship would carry away
wow.
with them. But we put more ice on, more layer of wood, and then it's ice fish, ice wood, ice fish, ice wood, right up to the ceiling. And we could have 90 tons of fish down here
wow.
if the ship was full.
Can we take a look a little bit further down?
We can. We can
here?
Go through to the engine room, through
okay.
this way. So So this is the main engine. We're in the engine room now. We've got a winch engine to power the big winch to wind up the nets that we saw. And this is the main engine to power the engines built at Lincoln. It was very, very loud down here, and the engineer had to be in here for 12 hours every day while the ship was at sea. So it was a tough place to work as well down under here.
Fantastic. Should we carry on through?
Yes, right through towards the accommodation.
Wow. So this is, I guess, the sleeping quarters.
This is what was known as a four-man berth. Four men would sleep down here. And of course, they've not had a wash for all the time they're on the ship, yeah. Which would be 2 or 3 weeks on big ships. And they're sleeping in the clothes they were working in with the fish on the deck.
Wow.
So it could get a little bit pongy down here as well.
Yeah, and snoring as well. Mind you, you probably can't hear anything if there's the engine
the sound
noise
of the engines
coming through.
And the propeller beneath our feet churning the water as well.
Wow.
Well, the cook was the most important person on the ship, or so a lot of people would say, because your meals were so important because we're working so hard. So all of these pans on the boil all the time, the spouts facing away from him because, of course, the ship is rolling, so everything has to be clamped tightly onto the top
of
the oven.
Amazing.
Big pans of this was often known as a pan of shackles, a stew that they could be having as well. So good hearty meals that are going to give them lots of energy so that they can do the job they need to do.
Wow. Where would they eat it?
In the room just next to us. This is the mess.
Wow, so this is where they'd eat their hearty meal.
It is. So you can imagine from all the cold wind, even frost and ice on your faces and in your hair, to sit down in here, have a big warm meal, a big pint mug of tea.
Oh, would feel amazing, wouldn't it?
It must have felt like heaven.
Fabulous. Where to next, David?
Well, I think we need to go up to the wheelhouse where the skipper would have commanded the Ross Tiger.
Great. Welcome back. We hope you enjoyed that. How exciting is it below the deck here on the trawler? We're now in somewhere else, which is just as exciting and very important, isn't it, David, in here? What happens?
It is. This is the wheelhouse. So this is where the skipper of the ship, that's the captain, would command the Ross Tiger.
Great. So it's called the wheelhouse, I'm guessing, because we have a ginormous wheel here.
That's right. That's the original mahogany steering wheel for the ship. And of course, today you don't see these in wheelhouses. We still call them wheelhouses, but they're steered with almost like a joystick that you'd use in a computer game.
Oh, wow. So everything's got all kind of mod cons. Because this looks quite technical here, but I'm guessing this is kind of like an old equivalent of a sat-nav.
It is, yes. Of course, they never had satellite technology in the 1950s. So this is what was called a Decca Navigator. It uses radio signals around the coast so that the captain knows where the ship is. He's also got something very important to him, and that's the compass. Of course, the compass tells you which direction you're going in. This is the most accurate one, but to keep accurate, the compass needs to be away from the steel and the metal. So that means it could get damaged in all the heavy seas and weather that the Ross Tiger would have. So you have a spare, this mirror, that mirror, and one in the ceiling above our head there.
Wow, this is magnificent.
That's right.
So this is floating in water, is it, David?
Well, it's actually a kind of an alcohol, because the Ross Tiger would sail to places so cold up in the Arctic that if it was water, it could freeze, and then it would stop working.
Ah, very, very clever indeed. I feel like I've gone back in time in here. Everything's really oldie-worldie. I think we should get back to present day now. And this is a very short video, and this is all about how fish gets to finger.
Fish fingers, from fish to finger. Once the frozen fish blocks of Alaska pollock arrive in the United Kingdom, they are taken by lorry to a cold store in Grimsby. The cold store is a huge warehouse that acts like a very big freezer. Inside, it's kept at minus 23 degrees Celsius. The first job they do at the warehouse is test the fish to make sure it's all of good quality. To do this, they take a sample and defrost it in a special testing facility like this one. The experts here analyse the fish, checking for bones and tasting and smelling the fish to make sure it's of a high enough quality to be made into fish fingers. Next, the fish blocks are taken to the fish finger factory. The frozen blocks of fish are sawn into fish finger shapes, like this, using a bandsaw. The bandsaw is controlled by a computer, so that each fish stick is exactly the same size. and this factory makes roughly 7 million fish fingers every week. The fish fingers are then passed through a waterfall of batter in a process called enrobing before being coated in breadcrumbs. The breadcrumbs are made from wheat flour and a little salt is added for more flavour. Finally, the fish fingers are fried in sunflower oil at 200 to 220 degrees Celsius for 32 to 40 seconds, which gives them a nice flavour. Once cooked, they are then frozen in this special freezer, which is a very chilly minus 18 degrees Celsius. They are then packed into boxes of 10 and stored in a large freezer. The fish fingers are now ready to be sent to the store to be bought and enjoyed for your dinner.
Welcome back, children. I hope you enjoyed learning all about how fish fingers are made. Give me a wave in your classrooms if you enjoyed learning all about that. Yay! Hopefully you're all going to try doing that at home. We are going to be learning from James how he's going to make his fish finger sandwiches for us in a second. Absolutely. You've been working very hard, James. But first of all, let's get some questions for our Davids again. Let's go over to Woodlands Academy to see if Mr. Handley's class has any questions.
My name's Bella and my question is, we have heard that fish fingers were first created in Great Yarmouth, which is very close to our school. Is that true?
Let me just check for you, Bella. Bella would like to check if fish fingers were first made in Great Yarmouth, which is right by their school.
Well, it's a really good question, that, isn't it? And we do think that Great Yarmouth was one of the first places in the UK that fish fingers were made. And fish fingers are a very early frozen food as well, from the 1950s, which was the era that this ship was designed and built.
Great stuff. Well done, Bella. That's a really, really good fact there. Let's get another question from Woodlands Academy.
Hi, my name is Harley. My question is, how are you limited to the number of fish that you are allowed to catch? If not, how do you make sure there are still fish in the sea for our fish fingers?
That's a really good question. So, David, Harley would like to know, is there a limit to the number of fish you can catch? And if so, how do you make sure there's enough fish that are kept in the oceans?
Oh, that is a really good question, Harley. There is a limit to the number of fish you can catch, and that is called a quota. And a quota is basically an allowance or a number of fish that's given to each fisherman, so he knows how many fish he can catch without catching too many, so we've got enough fish for the next year and it's very sustainable. So the big quota will be made for the entire stock. Marine biologists like myself will work at how many fish are out there, how many are allowed to catch, and the government will give that to each fisherman so he knows exactly what to catch.
Great. Really great questions from Woodlands Academy. Let's get some questions now from Front Street Primary. Do we have any questions from Mr. Hollingsworth class?
Hello, my name is Connie, and my question is, what is the biggest catch of fish you have ever made, and how long do you leave the nets in the sea to catch them all?
Thank you, Connie. What a great question. This was one for you, David. So Connie would like to know, what's the biggest fish that's ever been caught, and how long do you leave the nets in when you are catching fish?
Right, okay, well, the Ross Tiger finished fishing a long time ago, before I was actually born, although we did have family that worked on this ship. But really, the nets were down, depending how long the captain wanted them down for. It could be 2 to 4 hours, maybe, before he feels that weight in his trawl. Then they'll bring it all up, see what they've got, and you could get a lot of fish in a good haul. So you could have 2 tons of fish in the cod end. So it's a lot of fish that all has to be worked on this deck.
Fantastic stuff. Amazing. Great question, Connie. Let's get one last question from Mr. Hollingsworth, class.
Hello, my name's Fraser, and what is the most frightening or dangerous thing you have ever had to deal with when you're working out at sea?
Really great question, Fraser. So Fraser would like to know, David, what's the most dangerous thing that you have to deal with when you're out at sea?
Okay, well, that's a great question, Fraser. There's lots of different things that can be quite scary out at sea. First is the actual catch itself. So when you bring up the nets, you you're looking for your lovely cod and haddock and pollock that we've talked about today, but you might get things like a shark we talked about earlier, or an angry octopus, or a crab with very sharp pincers. So you've got to watch out for the catch itself. And then the other bit, I'm afraid, is we've got to watch out for the weather. So on a nice day, like when the sun shines now, it's beautiful. It's a lovely time going out to sea. But when you get big weather and big wind and big waves, your boat can be going up the wave and down the wave, and you've got to hold on really tight, and you can get a bit cold and wet. So you've got to make sure you wrap up warm and always keep an eye on the weather.
Wow. Great stuff. Really fantastic questions today, children. Really great stuff. I think it's time, because it's just smelled so good all throughout this lesson, that we check in with James and finally see these fish fingers being made.
You've seen fish fingers being made in the factory. We thought you might like to have a go at making some yourself. Now, if you really want to impress people, you can tell them what the posh word for fish fingers is, which is goujons.
Ooh.
Okay. So whenever you're in a restaurant and it says goujons, really you're just talking about fish fingers. Okay. Now, to make these fish fingers, we just need four ingredients. We need some fish. So we've got a lovely pollock that's probably about 4 hours out of the sea. Some flour, some eggs, and some breadcrumbs. That's it.
Wow.
Okay. Now,
and could you use other fish other than pollock?
Absolutely, you could use pretty much any fish you like. You could use some cod, some haddock, some salmon. In fact, the recipe that you've got in school is for the salmon fish fingers.
Ooh, lovely.
Because we're talking about pollock, we've changed it. It's that easy to change.
Great.
Okay. Now, before I get on with this, you've also got in school some tartar sauce. So what we thought we'd show you is how to make tartar sauce. So if I can get some help from you guys doing that, that would be great.
Absolutely.
So, if I can get you, Chef, please, to chop my herbs for me.
Right,
all you need to do is put your scissors in the pot and chop away. Right. Okay.
It's
and
like
then if I can get the tartar sauce being made. So I've got a clean mixing bowl. Okay. I've got some mayonnaise. I've got some lemon zest. I've got some chopped up gherkins, which are just a kind of pickled cucumber. I've got some capers, which are a nasturtium berry, okay? Nice peppery taste, okay? And also some lemon juice. So if I can get you, Chef, just to combine all of those in that bowl for me, that would be
Absolutely.
Great.
No problem.
I think you're supposed to say, yes, Chef. Yes,
yes,
chef.
Chef.
Yes, Chef.
Thank you very much. Right, now, when you're making your fish fingers, okay, top tip, use one hand. Okay, because if you use two hands, you will end up in a big mess. So what we're going to do is we're going to dip our fish, which we've cut into the size we want, in our flour. Okay. We're now going to dip it into our beaten egg.
Make it nice and sticky.
Yep, because what we want is we want something for our breadcrumbs to stick to. Now, this is a really good recipe if you've got a bit of bread sticking around at home that's possibly no good for sandwiches because it's gone a bit stale, but you could use this to make some breadcrumbs,
yeah.
Or you could make a load of breadcrumbs and then pop them in the freezer, and then you've got them ready whenever you want.
Lovely. It's nice and messy, isn't it, James?
It is, but this is why we only use one hand, so you've always got a clean hand.
Very
pop
clever.
In the pan. If you're cooking, you need to have an adult, okay? So that's the one I've just popped in. This is the batch that I've made earlier. So we cook them for about 2 minutes on one side and then probably about 2 minutes on the other.
Oh,
okay.
They smell so good,
what
James.
What you can do, they do smell good, don't they?
Mm.
What you can do, if you're not sure if they're cooked, is slice one open and have a look. It should be the same colour the whole way through. If it's not quite the same colour in the middle, give it a little bit longer. Okay, how are we doing with our sauce, chefs?
We're all done.
Final mix.
All
excellent.
Done, Chef.
Okay. We could make a fish finger sandwich with sliced bread, but we thought, why not make a wrap? So.
You can get more into a wrap, can't you, James?
You can.
Shove it all in.
You can. And it's easier
to
eat.
Wrap.
It's food
mm.
on the go. So we just need a wrap. We've got some nice shredded lettuce. A bit of tomato, a bit of colour, a bit of flavour. We need a couple of bits of our goujons, or fish fingers, that we've already cooked.
The Davids are, you're getting excited, aren't you, both of you?
So
okay.
Hungry right now.
We've been smelling it for ages.
Sorry, Sam, get in front of you.
There
and
you
then,
go.
A big dollop of our tartar sauce. Okay. Then, excuse me a moment, all we're going to do is give it a big old wrap up and we're good to go.
Lovely.
Okay.
I think James and David should have the first sample because they've been working very, very hard.
They have. So while I slice this up, excuse fingers, chef, they are clean. I have washed my hands.
Thank you very much, chef.
There we go. Mind your shirt,
chef.
Brilliant. Okay. And of course, fish fingers are a good source of protein, which is really important for normal growth and strong muscles, and a source of calcium as well, which we need for healthy, strong teeth. And we've come to the end of this online field trip. How are you doing there, boys? Nice?
Delicious.
Lovely.
Absolutely beautiful, chef. Thank you very much.
I think we should just go to all of our schools and find out what we have learnt today. So let's go to Forward Primary School in Essex to see what Miss Bird's class has learnt.
My fact is that Alaska pollock eggs float above the water till they hatch.
Oh, that's a really good fact. So Miss Bird's class have learned that Alaska pollock's eggs float above the water till they hatch, David.
Yeah, that's a great fact, actually. There's a little bit of lipid or fat in the egg and it helps them float to the surface, and that's away from predators at the bottom that might eat the eggs. And then when the eggs hatch, they swim back down to the bottom. And the eggs are actually a very important food source for lots of different animals. So for example, some of the large whales will actually eat little pollock eggs. So the pollock end up making about 100 times more eggs than they actually need, just because so many things eat it. So it's a very important part of the ocean. But
wow.
Great fact, thank you.
Really great fact. And let's go to Greenway Primary School now to find out what you've learnt.
Hello, my name's Casey, and my fact is that machines make fish fingers and they're not made by hand.
That's a really great fact. So Mrs. Donnelly's class have learned that fish fingers are made by machines and not by hand, unless you make them at home. Let's go over to Woodlands Academy now to find out what Mr. Handley's class has learned.
Hi, my name is Callum, and my fact that I've learned today is that the trawlers have a factory inside them.
That's a really, really great fact. So Mr. Handley's class has learned, David, that the trawler has a factory inside them.
Yes, Hello. Certainly today, compared to the days of the Ross Tiger, of course, when everything was done out in the open ears. That had to be tough years ago, and even still today, on those big trawlers. Yeah.
Great learning. Finally, let's go to Front Street Primary School now and find out what Mr. Hollingworth's class has learned.
My name's Matthew, and I found out that it's very dangerous to be a trawler man.
Right, that's great. So they've learned that it's very dangerous to be a trawler man. Very dangerous indeed, but a very rewarding job.
Absolutely, very important and very rewarding job.
Fantastic. Well, we've come to the end of this online field trip. Thank you so much to David. Thank you so much, James, for your amazing cooking. And thank you so much for joining us, children, today. And if you'd like to take part in our next online field trip, we've got a very special end of term extravaganza. We're going to be a day at the country show. We're going to be meeting lots of farmyard animals. We're going to be finding out where all our favourite food comes from as well. That'll be on the 3rd of July, so don't forget to join us for that. And don't forget, if you'd like to take part in a school farm to fork field trip, all you need to know is online on our website. It is lots and lots of fun. You really get stuck in, just like the children you can see on the screen right now. So get signed up for that one. But from myself, James, and the Davids here in Grimsby, it's goodbye because we're going to eat our fish finger sandwiches.
Bye. Bye, guys.
Goodbye, everybody. Goodbye, Forward Primary School.
Bye.
Goodbye, Greenway Primary School. Goodbye, Woodlands Academy.
See you later.
And finally, goodbye, Front Street Primary School. Thank you so much for joining us. Goodbye.